Today we're going to have the current events of Torah. Please take a chumash. I have the books over here if you want to pass them back. The shir is Le'ela Nishmas, Osher Shmuel Chaim Ben Ephraim Mitziona, Esther Bas Sarah, Rivka Bas Yitzchak Isaac. Le'ela Nishmas Tzvi Dov Ben Chaim Pesach. Yitzchak Ben Sarah, Leah Bas Simcha. Le'ela Nishmas Avraham Ben Mordechai, David. Then it was Reuven ben Shmuel, Chana Golda bas Yisrael, Chaim ben Fega, Yeshua ben Shmuel, Chana Ita bas Moshe David, then it was Mordechai Netzach ben Rivka. We're going to do the Aftorah. We're going to do the Aftorah on the what?
Can I give a name?
Bakasha.
Heni Rasha bas. Bas Moshe Chaim.
Then it's Matam. Before we get to the Aftorah, we know that the Pasha of the week also speaks to current events as well, not just the Torah. In the Pasha of the week, Pasha's Vayera, Bereishis Yutes, Pasuk Chav Dalet, you have the Chumashim in front of you, you want to use them or pass them back. Bereishis Yutes, Pasuk Chav Dalet, Vashem Himter Al Sodom Val Amora. It says, God destroyed Sodom and Amora. Bereishis 19, Pasuk 24. So the question is, normally when you have God's stern justice, it doesn't say Yudke Vovke, it says Elohim. Should have said, Bereshis Yutes, Pasuk 24, Velehim Himter Al Sodom. Because whenever you have God's strict, stern justice, it doesn't say Yudke Vovke, it says Elohim. Here, God is destroying evil, and it doesn't say Elohim, it says Vashem Himter Al Sodom. Hashem is what? Midas Rachamim, compassion. Is it Rachamim to destroy Sodom? Why doesn't God use Elohim, Midas Adin? Yes, to destroy evil, that's Rachamim. When you destroy evil terrorists, that's compassion. What a powerful pasuk, current events. God destroyed the evil of Sodom, it doesn't say Elohim. It says, Dafke, Yudke, Vavke, Midas HaRachamim, with compassion. So the message to our current leaders in current events is that you have to destroy evil, not to wound them, shoot them in the head. When you destroy evil, wicked terrorists, that's an act of compassion. And therefore, it doesn't say Elohim, it says Yudke, Vavke, destroyed evil. Let's take a look at the Aftorah. In current events, you don't have to buy a Jerusalem Post. You look at the Aftorah that we read last Shabbos. In Pasha's Lech Lecha on the Aftorah, you have the books in front of you. It's the Aftorah Pasha's Lech Lecha. That's in the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, Pasuk Lamed. Noten layoef koach ulein onim otzma yarbet. God gives strength to the weary. And those who have no power, God gives them superhuman strength. That's the Aftorah of last week. Pashas Lech Lecha, Isaiah chapter 40, Pasuk 30. How do we get through the stressful times? Stress, trying days. How do you prevent from cracking up? So God tells us in last week's parasha, the Aftorah, Lech Lecha, Noten layoef koach. Reuben, you have that? God gives us strength to get through the stress of these trying, distressful days. Lein onim otzma yarbet. And Aftorah continues. We're still in Lech Lecha. We didn't get yet to, I bought the chumashim, you can look it up. In Lech Lecha, God tells us the Aftorah, Pasuk Yud. Altira, don't be afraid, ki imcha ani, I am with you. Altishta, don't panic. Don't have a panic attack. Ki ani alecha, I am your God. Imatzticha, I will give you strength. Afazartich, I will also what? Help you. Aftamachticha, I think it went off. I will support you, b'min, Sitki, with the strength of my right hand. So again, from last week's Aftorah, in Pashas Lech Lecha, it's amazing how current events, how the Pasha always speaks to what? The Aftorah, Miki, to current events, God says, don't panic, don't be afraid. I am helping you. I am holding your right hand. B'min Sidki. And the Haftorah continues. Just amazing. And Pasuk Yud Gimel. Haftorah Pashas Lech Lecha. Pasuk Yud Gimel. You hear this, Elisheva? Keni Adonai Elhecha. I am Hashem, your God. Magzik Yivenecha. I'm holding tight to your right hand. Oy Melecha. And I say to you, Al Tira. Don't be afraid, Ani Zarticha, I will what? Help you. Isn't that incredible current events?
Yes.
That's why I brought the Chumashim in front of you. It's just amazing how the Haftorah from last week is speaking directly to what? To our Matzav today, where God gives strength to the weary, not to crack up from the stress. God says, I'm holding your right hand tight. I'm not going to let go. Al tira, don't be afraid. Ani azarticha, I what? Am helping you. That's the Haftorah that we read last week. What about this week? Haftorah's Vayera. I'll give you a chance to get there. Haftorah's Vayera, it's in the book. Just have to, I don't have the same page as you have, but it's the Haftorah, Ilani. There's an extra book there if you want it. There's an extra book there. No, we have plenty. Just have to use them. Haftorah's Vayera. V'isha achas. Now we know the Haftorah doesn't speak about current events, but the Haftorah also has to connect to what? To the Parsha. So the Parsha we read about Echnosas Orchim, we read about the Akedah. How does it tie into what? To the Haftorah. And then we'll see how they tie into what? To today's headlines. So I'm reading the Haftorah of Vayera. Hope you're with me. The Isha Achas Min Shei B'nei Anavim Tza'aka Elisha Lamor. A certain woman from the wives of the prophet's disciples cried out to Elisha saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that he feared God greatly. But now the creditors have come to take my two sons into slavery. Who was this widow? This was the widow of the great prophet Ovadia. The great prophet Ovadia, who was a convert to Judaism from Edom. He risked his life when Isabel and Ahab were killing out the prophets of Hashem. He risked his life to hide Nevi'im in caves, and he supported them from his own money, and he became bankrupt. And he died.
Didn't have an
IRA. Now the wife can't pay the debts. He put himself in debt in order to support these Nevi'im, to hide them from the murderous zeal of Ahab and Jezebel. Now that he died, as Herb would always say, no good deed goes unpunished. This great tzaddik, Reuven, Ovadia, risked his life, defied the king. He was an official in the king's court. He defied the king. The king said, all Jewish prophets. He hid them in caves, supported them from his own money, died prematurely. Now he's bankrupt. He put himself in hock to save the Nabi Hashem. Now his widow is crying to Elisha. Is that fair? Now they're taking my two sons because I can't pay the debts that my husband put in debt to save your colleagues, Elisha. Huh? So what's the connection between the Parsha, Ilana? Avraham Avinu, the righteous man, and his righteous son, God says, take your son and what? And kill him. We see that the ways of God are so mysterious. Why do the righteous suffer and the wicked prosper? Who's more righteous than Abraham? Look how much he suffered. And Ovadia, the great convert to Judaism, the great prophet, because of his Echnosas Orchim, now he's in hock, and his wife can't pay the debts, and now his kids are being taken. In the ancient world, you couldn't pay your debts. They would take the creditor would come and take the kids to be slaves. So what does Elisha answer her, Reuven? What does Elisha answer her? I'll read it in English, we'll go faster. Elisha said to her, "What can I do for you? Tell me what you have in the house." Why did he ask that? He wants to do a miracle. So he asked her, "What do you have in the house?" So what does she say in Pasuk 3? "Your maidservant has nothing in the house except one jar of oil." Why is that important, what he has in the house? He asked her, why? What's that important? So the Talmud learns from here that in order for a miracle to take place, it can only take effect on something that already exists. Yesh Mayayin, only God can do. Prophets can do miracles, Nechama, but it has to be on something that already exists, and then he can just multiply it. Yesh Mayayin. So she said, "I have one little jar of oil." Okay? So what did he say to her in Pasuk 3? "Go borrow vessels for yourself from the outside, from all your neighbors. Empty vessels, as many vessels as what? As you can what? Get." Pasuk 4, "Then go and shut the door behind you, with you and your sons. Pour the oil into all of the vessels and carry away the full ones." So Elisha said what? Okay. "Borrow as many empty crock pots as you can. Shut the door behind you and pour that little cruse of oil that you have." You'll keep on going and going and going and going. Why do you say shut the door? Why is that important?
In our parsha, the angels have to shut the door a number of times.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a relation, I don't know.
That's a good question. Why to shut the door? What? You don't advertise a miracle? That's a very good point, Malka said. She said, but later on, in Eliyahu HaNavi, before the Rebbe of Elisha, didn't he make a miracle on Mount Carmel where the fire came down and thousands of people saw it? Yeah. Here, good point. Here, no. The miracle has to be done dafka behind closed doors. What's the message? Why is that? Interesting. So the Talmud explains, Ilana, that all the prophets besides Moshe, Yeshua, there are many exceptions, but most prophets only did miracles privately. There are Moshe Rabbeinu is an exception, right? Yeshua ben Nun is an exception. He stopped the sun, Elisha. But most prophets, their miracles are done, I think it's called on the QT, David, on the QT. Question is why? Right? Our exceptions, Holy Moses, Yeshua, Eliyahu, and Har Carmel, but most of the Nevi'im, their miracles were done on the QT. What's the message? I think there's a message there. To be modest, to be humble, don't brag, don't boast, keep a low profile. Okay? Pretty interesting, right? So anyway, back in the Haftorah, she went from him and shut the door behind her and behind her children. They brought the vessels and she kept pouring and pouring, and guess what, Aviva? Keeps on going and going. When all of the containers are full, she said to her son, what? Bring me another vessel. He said to her, sorry, mommy. What did he say? There's no more. And once he said that, the oil stopped pouring. So a miracle can only take place on something that what? That already exists, right? What's the message, Mickey? Couldn't God make a miracle from nothing? Yes. But this world is a partnership. God says, you want me to fight terror? Take off the gloves of the IDF, BB. Take off the gloves of the, untie their hands. Yeah. Ilana, current events. God could do it all, but this world is a partnership, buddy. David, incredible current events in the Haftarah. You want me to do my part, God says? You have to do yours. Untie the hands of the IDF. What are you playing games with them for? Incredible. You don't do yours, the oil stops. David, current events. Once we start making ishtadlut, we stop, then God says, I have to stop. You guys do yours, and only then, Rose, will I do mine. So, she came and told the man of God, what should I do? I have a bonanza here. I have gallons and gallons of oil. Oil, $100 a barrel. Now, how much is it now? Went down to 50. Reuben, she...
This is olive oil.
Olive oil is also 50 shekels a little jar. Come on.
First press.
Right? 50 shekels a little bottle. Elisheva. She's now rich in oil. She came and told the man of God, what should I do with it? Should I invest it in what? Enron. What should I do with it? Stocks? Mutual funds? What should I do with it? Amazing. She went to the Rebbe. Reuben, right? You went to the Rebbe to ask, how do I invest this wealth? Yohanan, pretty amazing, huh? So what did he tell her? Go, sell the oil, pay your creditor, and you and your sons will live on what? On the profits. So she went to console the Rebbe to invest, you know, not in penny stocks. No, Yehuda, not penny stocks. What? Blue chips. Okay, this is one story from the Navi. Again, the message for today is, Ilana, we have to do our part, only then will God do his. And if we don't unleash the IDF to do what they're capable of doing, then God says, what do you want from me? Incredible current events. What?
And it's for this week.
And this week? No coinky dinky? Right? And it ties in with the Parsha. Abraham was a great chesed man. This guy Avadi was a great chesed man. And more than that, Abram is called Av HaMoin Goyim. Abram is called the father of all converts. And this great Ovadia, who was a pagan, became Ovadia. What does Ovadia mean?
Servant
of God, the great Navi Ovadia. And he was the great Achnosos Archim, like his great, great spiritual father, Abraham. And yet the righteous in this world somehow, why did the righteous suffer? He died prematurely, his widow is now suffering. But in the end, it turns out good, right? Hashem did a miracle for her because she was willing to do her ishtadlut. Another story with Elisha. You have it, Ilana? Next story with Elisha. It happened one day, Elisha traveled to Shunam. You see that, Yehuda?
That's verse 8.
There was a great woman there, Isha Gedolah. A great woman. A great chesed woman. Like whom? Mama Sarah. You see how it fits in? Avadia is a great chesed man like Abraham, Avadia, the great Navi. And now we have Isha Gedolah, who followed in the footsteps of what? Of Mama Sarah, the great Achnas. And both of them were barren. And both of them couldn't have children. And both of them Hashem did a miracle for. So this great woman, and she what? And Elisha would be like a circuit judge. He would make the rounds, right? So whenever he would pass by the town of what? Shunem, this great woman would what? Invite him to eat. What? Always he has to eat by her. Eat by her. So what does she propose to her husband? She said to her husband, I know that he is a holy man, a man of God who passes by regularly when he gives lectures here. Let us make a small room for him in the attic, place there a bed, a table, and a chair. Why is that important, Reuven, for the year 2015? The Tanakh is not a history book. She tells her hubby, let's build, get a permit. From the Iriah. No, not so easy, Ilana. We'll build a second floor for this man of God. And what are we going to put in there? Mita, Shulchan, kisei u'menorah. A bed, a table, a chair, and what? A menorah. So whenever he comes by, he can what?
Be comfortable.
Comfortable. Lodging. Here you have the connection to the parsha. In the parsha. In the parsha, Abraham plants an eshel. What does eshel stand for? Achila, shtia, lina. Food, drink, and what? And staying over. And the after Elisheva, this great lady follows in the footsteps of Mama Sarah and Abraham, also supplying food, drink, and lodging. So she asks her husband whether she can hire, not Arab contractors, maybe Chinese contractors, to build an upper chamber, next floor. But why is it important, Reuven, to put a bed, table, and chair and a lamp? Why is that important?
Well, you said for comfortability, but not only that.
Yeah.
It sounds like also the parsha with the Ohel Sarah, because then later on we're going to learn next week's parsha, I think, that there's light always in
the... Oh, beautiful, Reuven. Her tent has always been menorah. Uh-huh, very good. Her light never went out. The menorah never went out. So, I think the message is, when you invite a guest over to sleep over, you have to give him what? A bed, a table, a chair, and what? And light. Right? If you want to do it right. I think it went off again. If you want to do it right. Okay? So, you had a question, Malka?
Would this be a template for
a Mishulachim?
Would this be a template for Israel or this or that?
Right, you want to, yeah.
Table and
chair. Supply him with the,
the basic minimum.
You do it right. The message is do it right. Vehi ayom, Pasuk 11 or 12. Vehi ayom, Yoveh Shama, Yoseh, Liyav, Yishkav Shama. So one day on his rounds, he arrived there, and he turned to the attic and he took a nap. Right? So he said to Gehazi, Pasuk 12. You have that, Ilana?
Mm-hmm.
Pasuk 12. He said to Gehazi, all great rabbis have shamosim. I think it's called a butler. So he said to his attendant Gehazi, his shamus, right, buddy? The shamus, Gehazi. He said what? Call her shunamit, call this shunamit lady. Call her. I want to give her what? A bracha. She's so kind to us, right? So considerate. I don't have to stay in Motel 6. Right? So call her and I want to give her a bracha. Right? And 13, he then said to Gehazi, say to her, because you have undertaken on behalf of us all this great what? Bother that you do for us, right? Ma lasas lecha. What favor can be done for you? Hayesh davalach al hamelech. Can something be said to you on behalf of the king? I'm in tight with the king, says the Navi. Ask me a favor. You want your arnona lowered, lower taxes, right? Not to pay so much arnona, right, Elisheva? Hayesh davalach al hamelech. Can I speak to you for the king? Put in a good word for you. Says the Zohar, Reuven. This took place on Rosh Hashanah. And he said to her, I'm in tight with the boss. Hayesh ledabalach el hamelech. I know you need a child. You want me to make a special tefillah for you, el hamelech malchei hamlochim. I'm in tight with the boss. I'll daven special for you. Rosh Hashanah, the Yom HaMelech Malchei HaMelechim. Vatoyme, what did she say? V'toich Ami Anochi Yoshevet. She said what? No, thank you. I dwell amongst my people. Says the Zohar, what an answer. Elisha, the great Navi, I'm going to daven special for you. Today's Rosh Hashanah. I'll speak to the Melech Malchei Amlachim. You need help. Give me your name and your mother's name. She said, B'toich Ami Anoichi Yoshevet. What an answer, Elisheva. Don't single me out. I'm nobody special. There are many barren women, many people that are sick, B'toich ami anoichi yoshevet. I dwell amongst my people. I'm part of Klal Yisrael. I'm not the only woman that needs a Yeshua. What about all the other women? What an answer. What an answer. B'toich ami. Don't single me out. Pray for all women that need and all people that need a Yeshua, a Refuah. What an answer, she said. B'toich ami anoichi yoshevet. I'm nobody special. I'm part of the Klal Yisrael. Don't single me out. Vayomer, right? So he said to the Shamas, Elisha said to a Shamas, 14, you see that? But still, what can be done for her? What does she need special? So Gehazi said, in Pasuk 14, she has no child and her husband is very old. And she's old. The same story with the Parsha, David. Avram and Sarah, they're ready for a nursing home. They have no kids. Same thing with her. So he called her. Pasuk 15, he called her. In Pasuk 15, Vayomer, Lamoad Azer Ke'et Chaya. At Chayveket Ben. This is the only time in Tanakh, Ruvain, these words are used. In the Parsha, the Malach and God say to Abraham and Sarah, Lamoad Azer Ke'et Chaya. At this time in a year from now, you'll be alive and you'll have a baby boy. The exact language that God used in the Parsha to Mama Sarah, Elisha HaNaviwat, uses now to Mrs. Shunamit. The only times in Tanakh these words are used, Reuven. La'moed azeh ke'et chaya. At this time next year, you'll both be alive. Healthy mommy, healthy baby. At choyveket ben. Hugging a child. And the Talmud says that this baby grew up to be the great prophet Habakkuk. What does Habakkuk mean? The hugged one. The hugged one. In 1 year's time, at choyveket ben, you will be hugging a child. A miracle. She's ready for the nursing home, like Mama Sarah. So therefore, he became the great prophet Habakkuk. Habakkuk means the hugged one. So this is the Navi, the greatest gadol in the world, telling her, great news. You're not ready for the nursing home. You'll be changing diapers next year. This is the Navi Hashem talking. She knew who he was, this great miracle worker. So she should have said what? Amen. She should have said amen. You know what she says? Please know, man of God, don't lie to me. Reuven, is that normal? The Godel Hador, he's the biggest Rebbe in the world. He's a Novi Hashem. She called him Isha Elohim. Gives her such a waiting all her life to have a baby. And he promised her a baby next year. She should have said, oh, Rabbi, thank you. Amen. I'll write you a big check for your yeshiva. No, she says, oh, man of God, don't lie to me. Wow. That's a normal answer, buddy.
It is. She was
don't lie to me. You're talking to the Navi Hashem. What's going on? What's going on? And more important, what's the message for me for the year 2015? That's an answer. You give a Navi Hashem. You go to a Rebbe for a bracha. And the Rebbe gives you a bracha. You say, don't lie to me, Rebbe. Says the Gemara in Sanhedrin. She was a great lady. She had Ruach HaKodesh. She knew Nechama that this child of hers is not going to live. This was a philosophical debate between her and the Navi. She knew that this child of hers was not going to live. Because she had Ruach HaKodesh. She said, you're going to give me a sick child who's going to die? Better not to have a child in the first place. And the Navi said, sorry. Even a sick child, how long you have him? Every moment is precious. That was their philosophical debate. She said, if the baby is born sick and he won't live, better not to have him at all. And the Navi said, you're wrong. Any child, even if you have them for a moment, is precious and has a value.
Amen.
So this was their debate over here. So, Pasuk 17, the woman conceived, bore a son, exactly next year as Elisha told her. But Pasuk 18, David, what happened? The boy grew up, he went out to his father to help him what? In the office. And he said, his father, my head, my head. He had a sunstroke or whatever, a stroke. His father, Pasuk 18, you have that? His father said to the one of the workers, carry him to his mother. Child gets sick, what does the father say?
Take him to his mother.
Carried him and brought him to his mother. He sat in her lap until noon, and the baby, the child, died. She knew this is going to happen, so therefore, instead of giving me a sick child, better not to have no child in the first place. But the Navi said, you're wrong.
How old was he?
Doesn't say how old he was. He was a child. So the child died. She knew that. And therefore she said, don't lie to me. So what happened in Pasuk 21? She went up and laid him where she went up to the attic. Whose room? Elisha's room. She laid him on the bed of the man of God, and she shut the door. Very bizarre, David, she did not even tell her own husband that their child is dead. And shut the door. Pasuk 22, Reuven. She called her husband and she said, get me a Nesher taxi. Pasuk 22. Please send me one of the attendants and one of the drivers, the donkeys. I can hurry to the man of God and return. She doesn't tell her husband that what?
God.
That he died. I need an emergency. I have to go to what? To see the Navi. I have to go see the Navi. So what does he say to her? Pasuk 23. Why are you going to him today? It's not the new moon and it's not Shabbos. Huh? Why you want to go to him today? It's not the new moon and it's not Shabbos. So she said, what? Mind your own business. No, she said, Yeh beseder, David. She said, Yeh beseder. Why is she keeping this terrible secret to herself, buddy? Why is she not telling her husband that the child is dead? Can't share the terrible news.
Terrible.
Huh?
Right? We don't share terrible news. We don't give over bad tidings.
Okay.
We try not to.
Okay. So anyway, the Gemara learns from here that you're supposed to go visit your Rebbe on Yom Tov. Because the Pasuk says that what? It's not new moon and it's not Shabbos. So why are you going to him? So the Gemara Rosh Hashanah says from here you learn out you're supposed to visit your Rebbe on Regel. Well, how do you learn from here? Here it doesn't say Regel. It says what? It says what? Chodesh and Shabbos. So how does the Talmud learn from here you should visit your Rebbe on Yom Tov? Here we're not talking about Yom Tov. We're talking about what? Shabbos and Rosh Chodesh. So what do you learn from Yom Tov? Huh?
What day was this? I don't understand.
It was a regular day, but the husband said to her, why are you going to him? It's not Rosh Chodesh and it's not Shabbos. So you see, there was a custom for women to visit the Navi when? Rosh Chodesh and Shabbaton. But how does the Talmud learn from here that you're supposed to visit your Rebbe on Yom Tov? Didn't say anything about Yom Tov here, David. It says what? Rosh Chodesh and Shabbos. So where did the Talmud learn out that men have to visit their Rebbe what? On Yom Tov. So the Tzlach answers, Rosh Chodesh and Shabbat was Chofesh. They had no class on Rosh Chodesh and Shabbat. There were no male students there. So the women can go on Rosh Chodesh and Shabbat to visit the Navi, because the men are no mixed dancing. The men are off. But on Yom Tov, when all the men go, the women shouldn't go. So you see, you have separation of the sexes even then. Rosh Chodesh and Shabbat, when the men didn't go, that's when the ladies would go. Yom Tov, when the men went, then the ladies went. Right, not to have a mingling of the sexes. So anyway, she doesn't share the terrible news with her husband. So what happens in Pasuk 24, Yehuda? You have, buddy, you have a book, no? Pasuk 24, why is it important she saddled the donkey and said to her attendant, what did she say to her attendant, Reuven, in verse 24? What'd she say to him?
Driving those who might impede me from dying unless I tell you.
Speed it up? What do you mean, drive and go? Why is that important? Huh?
She's in a hurry.
She's in a hurry. So she set out and came to the man of God at Mount Carmel. Mm-hmm. So what happened in Pasuk 25, Yehuda? When the man of God saw her, because he lived on top of the mountain, he saw her coming. So he said, he didn't know yet. He didn't know. He said to Gehazi, his attendant, isn't that the Shunammite woman? She's coming. Where's she coming now? So in Pasuk 26, he says, please run toward and say to her, wow, Hashalom lach, Hashalom le'ishech, Hashalom la'yeled. What do you want to know? What do you want out of life? What do you want out of life? Hashalom lach. Are you have inner peace? Are you content? Hashalom le'ishech. Are you living in shalom with your husband? Shalom bayit. Hashalom la'yeled. How is your relationship to your child? He didn't know that the child was dead. He didn't know. So, sometimes God keeps a Navi in the dark, Elisheva. We don't know. But anyway, these questions are we have to ask ourselves every day, Malka. Hashalom lach. Do you have peace? Are you at peace with yourself? Hashalom l'ishech. Are you at peace with your spouse? Hashalom l'yeled. What is your relationship to your children? The three questions we have to ask ourselves day by day. Buddy, not ancient history. The Haftorah is God's GPS. GPS, God's personal system. She lies. Vatoymer Shalom. She lies. What does she say? All is well. She lies. Why does she lie? Why does she lie? She doesn't want the Shamus to know. Remember the Shamus? Gehazi. She doesn't want him to know. Why is that?
She wants to speak to the boss.
She wants to speak to the boss directly. So she lied. Are you allowed to lie? What's the tie into the Parsha? Buddy, in the Parsha, who else lies? Amazing. Sarah said, my husband is old and ready for a nursing home. He can't have kids anymore. That's what she said. But when God reported the incident, what did God say? What did God say?
She said she's too old.
God changed the truth and said that what? Not that my husband is old and washed up. I'm old and washed up. She never said that. God changed the truth, Elisheva. Ibnei Shalom biased, you could even lie. That's pretty amazing. So God changed the truth? Because if Abraham would have heard that Sarah said that what? You're washed up. Who's washed up? I'll show you. Can you imagine, Elisheva? They would have had a lover's quarrel. They've been married 75 years. And if God wouldn't lie, Abraham and Sarah would have a lover's quarrel. They did. So God had to change the truth to preserve Shalom Bayis. That's pretty amazing. Her response, it would disturb her Shalom Bayis. Maybe she's living in denial. Get it? In denial. In denial. Disturb her Shalom Bayis. What? So she lies to the Gabbai. In Pasuk 27, what happens, Reuven? She comes to the man of God and grabs his legs. That's not tznius, is it? Gehazi approached her to push her away. What? You don't grab the rabbi's legs. Keep your hands to yourself. But the man of God said, leave her alone. Her soul is bitter within her. And God has hidden the truth from me and didn't tell me that her son is dead. Finally, he got the message. He just got an email from the boss. Better late than never, that the child is dead. Wow. What a message. What's the message? She grabbed her leg. She didn't act properly, but she's verbitten. How do you say that? And God doesn't judge anybody when he's what? In anguish. Leave her be, said the great tzaddik. Leave her be. Her soul is bitter. Now she says to him in 28, Reuben, didn't I tell you this is going to happen? Look at note 28. You have it, Ilana?
Yeah.
Did I ask a son for my master? Did I not say, do not lie to me? If the child is not going to live, better not to have him altogether. And the Nabi said, it's not so. You have a child even for one day, you'll always have that day. Life is precious day by day. Amazing philosophical debate between two great people, buddy. Between the Navi and the Shunamit woman. Right? So anyway, what does he say in Pasuk 29? He says to Gehazi, what? Reuven, what does he say in 29? Gird your loins. What does that mean? Put on your girdle. Put on your pants, take my staff in your hand, and go. If you meet a person, do not greet him. If a man greets you, do not respond to him. Place my staff upon the lad's face, and you will resurrect him.
Wow.
So Elisha didn't go himself. First he sent the shamas. Don't greet anybody, Malka, because why? Don't waste any time. Don't waste any time. Because maybe it's already rigor mortis. You know, rigor mortis is?
This, the
starting to get stiff. Don't waste any time. She knew that this Gehazi is what? Not all there. Verse 30, the boy's mother said to the prophet of Hashem, what? Reuven, verse 30, what? She makes an oath. As Hashem lives, she swears that what? I won't leave you. She knew that Gehazi is not able to resurrect a dead child. She knew better than Elisha. Women have a bina yetera, buddy. It's called women's intuition. She knew that Gehazi would not be able to resurrect the dead boy, even though Elisha thought that he would. Women, Aviva, have a bina yetera. So she said, I'm not leaving you. So he arose and he went after her. Pasuk 31. She knew better than the Navi. Pasuk 31. What happened, Mickey? You have it? Ilana, verse 31. Gehazi went ahead and placed the staff on the boy's face, but there was no sound and nothing was heard. Didn't work. He returned toward Elisha and said, the dead boy is not awake. Right? So the Navi was shocked. But what did she say? I told you so. Women's intuition, even though she wasn't a Navi, but she had a Bina Yetena. Verse 32, Elisha came into the house, and the boy was dead, laid on whose bed?
His bed.
He entered, verse 33, he entered and shut the door behind him. Again, Yehuda, you do a great miracle. Most of them do miracles, but see now. Modest, low key, don't brag, don't boast. He entered and shut the door behind them, both him and the dead boy, and he prayed to Hashem. Okay? Verse 34, Reuven, what happened? He went up and lay upon the boy, placing his mouth upon his mouth. His eyes upon his eyes, his palms on his palms. He stretched himself over him and warmed the flesh of the boy. Incredible. He was doing mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. That's not going to help on a corpse. So the Radak says, All miracles are grounded in Teva. The person is not dead, but he's unconscious. You do mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, right? So even though the boy was dead, all miracles are grounded in Teva. And the Barbanel explains that the greatest miracle of all was splitting of the Red Sea. The Torah tells us there was Hurricane Katrina blowing all night and the Red Sea split. Why is that important? Couldn't God just snap his fingers and split the Red Sea? Says the Abarbanel that a hurricane blowing all night can't divide the waters. All miracles, Ilana, are grounded in Teva. So the Pasuk in Parshas Bishalach testifies, Hurricane Katrina blew all night, and then the waters were what? Parted. All miracles have to have a source in Teva. So even the greatest miracle of all, resurrection of the dead, he went through the motions, mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Why is that? Why do all miracles have to be disguised in Teva?
To give people to figure it out. That people don't see an open miracle. They have to figure out that really there is a miracle.
Beautiful. You guys are saying great. If the miracle was so obvious, like the nose on your face, we'd all be robots. So even when God does a miracle on, he has to leave the door open. Well, maybe a hurricane blowing all night can divide the waters to allow free will to continue to operate. Maybe the boy wasn't really dead, mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. So Shoshana, all miracles have to be grounded in Teva to allow free will to operate and to give you the chance to say what? Maybe it's not God. Stuff happens. Obama says stuff happens. Hurricane blowing all night will divide waters. Mouth-to-mouth resuscitation can bring back someone that looks like he's dead. But this is the idea that you said, Malk and Ruvain, in order to allow free will to continue to operate, otherwise if the miracle was so open and plain, we'd all be robots. And God doesn't want any robots, he wants partners. To be his partner, we have to have the Bechira Chofshis to say, well, maybe it's not God, despite that. Otherwise, we wouldn't be human. We need our free choice, so God has to disguise even great miracles in Teva. So anyway, what happened? Verse 35. He stretched out over him and he warmed his flesh. Verse 35. He withdrew and walked through the house, once this way and that way. He paced up and down, and he stretched himself over the boy again. The boy sneezed 7 times. Why is that important? Why, when you sneeze, you say Gesundheit?
Because Abraham Avinu died.
Before Yaakov Avinu came, it says Vayipach ba'apav nishmas chayim. God gave us the breath. He breathed into us through our nostrils the breath of life. So the way the neshama came in is the way the neshama goes out. So the boy sneezed 7 times. The neshama leapt through the nostrils, and now it comes back through the nostrils. And the boy opened his eyes. Wonder of wonder, miracles of miracles. Pasuk 36, Elisha called Gehazi and he said, what? What? Kurala Shunamut Hazot, called the Shunamit lady. So the Shamus called her, she came in and he said, what did he say? Se'i benech, pick up your son. He's going to be the great prophet Habakkuk.
Did he have that name,
Habakkuk? That they gave him name. Now the Talmud says that before him, Eliyahu HaNavi resurrected a dead boy. That dead boy became Yonah ben Amittai. Yonah the whale? That was the dead boy Eliyahu HaNavi resurrected. This boy that Elisha resurrected is the prophet Habakkuk. Because he said, you will be hugging your son. Habakkuk means the hugged one. So Apostle 37, she came, fell on his feet, bowed to the ground, picked up her son, and what? What's the message? How does it tie in, buddy? Innocent terror victims. Tragic death of children. It's a preparation for Tchiyat HaMesim. All death is only a preparation for eternal life. Tchiyat HaMetim, this boy died. The death of the body is the birth of the soul. Death is only a preparation for eternal life. So just like the Shunammite, we have in Israel today, mothers and fathers, young and old. We don't lose hope in these times of great distress. Right? All mothers and fathers are distressed. Send their kids off to work, to school. But we trust in Hashem to guide us. We are like the dead child. We've been revived after 2,000 years of exile and persecutions. We are the dead child revived back in Pisgat Zev. That's the greatest story of Tchiyat HaMesim. God revived us like the dead child after 2,000 years. And no one will drive us out.
That's right.
No matter what Abu Mamzer says.
That's right.
Yes?
Most famous thing
Very good. The doctor just told us. Habakkuk says that Tzadik Beminoto Yichye. Beautiful. What's your Hebrew name?
Chaim Eliyahu.
Dr. Chaim Eliyahu. What a word. The prophet Habakkuk said that Tzadik Beminoto Yichye. The Tzadik lives through Zemunah. Why is God doing this to us? Huh? Why did God have to kill me, cause my mother such anguish? We don't know, but we have emunah. What does emunah mean? Father knows best. Remember that program, I'm dating myself. Father knows best. Remember the kids didn't know, why is Abba doing this? It seems bizarre. But we have emunah that Father knows best. We don't understand what he's doing. But we trust him that whatever he does, David, is ultimately for our ultimate good. Because Father knows best. Even though we don't understand it. But we have emunah that Father knows best. So we don't lose hope. The great prophet Habakkuk, Tzadik Bemenosa Yichya. Emunah and bitachon, David. We throw those words around. Emunah and bitachon. How do you translate that, Ruben? Emunah means what?
Faith.
Bitachon? Trust. Are there synonyms? There are no synonyms in Hebrew. There are a lot of synonym buns, but there are no synonyms in Hebrew.
Wow.
Synonym ragalach, buddy? Synonym. So how do you differentiate between emunah and bitachon? Anybody know? Faith and trust. Give up?
Yeah.
Okay. Emunah, I believe that whatever happens to me is no chance. Gemara in Chulin, page 7, a person doesn't stub his toe or have a bad hair day unless God ordained it. That's emunah. Whatever happens to me, even the bad stuff, chas v'shalom, it's all ordained by him. There are no accidents and no coincidences. That's emunah. But bitachon is a higher level. I trust that even what I think is bad is ultimately for my good. That's a higher level, David. I can believe whatever happens to me all comes from him. Even the bad stuff. He ordained it. That's a very high level. But a higher level is, I have bitachon, that even the bad stuff, lo yaleinu, is somehow for my ultimate good. That's a higher level, Elisheva. Emuna, but bitachon, I trust him. That even what I think is bad, from my perspective, it is, chas v'sholom, I trust that ultimately it's for my good. That's a higher level. Yes, Nikivia.
I had read when you said that the wind blew all around.
Excuse me, and your husband, the Tzvi Dov and Chaim Pesach Zatzal, he had not just a munah, he had such bitachon. He told me many times that his suffering is for his own good. What a tzaddik he was. Wow. Tzvi Dov and Chaim Pesach, what bitachon he had. Not a munah only. A step higher, bitachon. Yes.
Beautiful.
Yeah, Barbanel saw something amazing. Let's talk about that. Once a year, the Nile turns a reddish color.
Yeah.
The Barbanel. Yeah. From the seaweed. And then it begins to stink, and the frogs can't live there, and they what?
Yeah.
And that leads to vermin, to disease and boils. So a person could say, well, it's all coinky-dinky.
Yeah.
But Mekina said, the timing. How did Moses know how to call it?
Oh, that's good.
Now, right?
It was much more
the timing. It was, of course, aggravated red color and more frogs than normal.
Wow.
But Anes is Teva taken to the next degree.
That's
but it's all grounded in Teva. Because to God, there's no difference. To him, nature and the supernatural is the same thing.
Yeah.
So therefore, all supernatural phenomena is grounded in nature, because to the boss, it's the same.
Of course, yeah.
It's all the same for him.
That's
right?
Anyway, Hashem resurrected our dry bones.
We are the resurrected child after 2,000 years.
Yeah,
weren't we spiritually dead? In Schmutz Laretz, and thank God we're revived, Aviva, like this child. What a powerful Haftorah. You don't have to buy Jerusalem Post, David, anymore. You can save 15 shekels. Come to this class. Subscription. You have a subscription to this class.
Amen.
Thanks to Yehuda Lev, he's taping it. Current events in the Haftorah. The Mishnah says in Avot, Hafochba, Vafochba, the Kulaba. Turn it over and keep turning around. Everything you want to know about anything is all in the Tanakh. You just have to know where to look. That's right. I'm just giving you the way to look. Every Thursday at 2, be here. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Toda rabah.